Welcome and good evening, everyone. Tonight is the occasion of the Gerald A. Soffen Memorial Lecture, a capstone of the 28th Space Studies program here hosted by Ohio University. We've saved the best for last. We've had 4 weeks of evening events where we have brought some of the best panels and the best speakers here to Ohio University as part of the ISU Space Studies program. And we're very pleased tonight to have Dr. Mikhail Marov as our speaker. Let me first say something about the Gerald Soffen Memorial Lecture. Gerry Soffen was a good friend of ISU. He was a good friend of science and of education and of space and of combining those things together. He was the creator of the NASA Academy, which is a sister program to ISU where undergraduates are brought together at various NASA centers and given a mini ISU type experience. Each year, we invite a distinguished lecturer to honor the accomplishments of Dr. Soffen. And tonight, we're honored to have Professor Marov deliver this year's Soffen Memorial Lecture. Mikhail Marov, my good friend, is a distinguished member of the Russian Academy of Sciences and of the International Academy of Astronautics. Mikhail graduated from the Moscow Technology University in 1958. He received his PhD in 1964 and full doctorate in physics and mathematics in 1970. His principal scientific interests are focused on the fundamental problems of hydrodynamics, gas kinetics, and space physics, with applications to solar system studies and cosmology, along with experimental studies of planets. Any of you who are lucky enough to hear his cosmology lecture as part of the ISU lecture series knows that Mikhail has been thinking about space and cosmology for a very long time. He's been deeply involved in many major events throughout the history of the Russian space program, beginning with the first flights to the moon and planets up to present time. He worked as project scientist or principal investigator on the Venera and Mars lander series and made the first in situ measurements in Venus and Mars atmospheres. So think about this, the Venera probes, the early Mars probes, this goes back to the very beginning of planetary science for any country. He also participated in the Vega, Phobos 88, Mars 96 projects. He was deeply involved in Phobos Grunt mission. In 94 and 95, Mikhail worked as visiting professor at North Carolina State University, where he was involved in the studies of NASA's Mars Mission Research Center. He's authored over 250 publications and refereed journals and has also published 15 books and monographs. Since 1989, Mikhail has been deeply involved with International Space University, and he's taught here over 23 times. He served as faculty, as co-chair in physical sciences department, and also has served as a member of our academic council and as a trustee. Professor Marov received two distinguished national awards, both that of Lenin and the state, and the International Galbert Award for Astronautics. Please help me welcome our Gerald A. Soffen Memorial Lecture tonight, Dr. Mikhail Marov.
Good afternoon, or good evening, right now, to everyone. I am so much pleased to be here. I mean, at the summer session, and certainly I especially pleased to have. It's a great opportunity to be a lecturer tonight and to speak about a good colleague and friend of mine for years, Dr. Gerry Soffen. Okay. Uh, Gerry has quite short lifetime. I knew him for 25 years. He graduated from UCLA, then University of South California, and he took his PhD in biology from Princeton University. He was deeply involved in different kind of the space exploration, but throughout the whole here life, career, he preserved especially tight involvement and interest to finding life elsewhere in the universe, and first of all, in the solar system. And he was for, in my memory, 7-8 years, the chair of Special Life Science Department in NASA. And his especially remarkable achievements are tightly related with his very deep involvement in historical Viking 1 and 2 project. And the main goal of these missions were just finding life, science of life on Mars. And Gerry dedicated to this endeavor significant part of his career, not everything was not controversial, and he occupied just as the leading position even after termination of this program, in order just to debate, to discuss, and even to disprove some kind of the, you know, quite negative response to the experimental studies that were carried out on the landers. As I said, Gerry was a very close friend of mine, and well, our acquaintance started quite unexpectedly, not face to face. He and me were nominated to be at the both sides of the hotline, which was organized by the decision of Russian Academy of Science and NASA, according to the special agreement signed between Russian President of Academy of Science, Mstislav Keldysh, and Deputy Administrator of NASA, George Low. And it happened in 1971, and it was at the first time in the history decided to organize a sort of bridge, hotline, and to exchange information, real-time information, of the operations of Mariner 9 and Russian, American, and Soviet Mars 3 orbiters. So we communicated, bridging this data exchange, and only a few years later, we got acquaintance face-to-face. Gerry was absolutely fascinating personality, not saying about he was great professional. And I've been very much lucky to know not only him, but his charming wife. She was Japanese born. And you know, we especially closely contacted in the framework of the ISU program, like John mentioned, and we preserved this friendship for many years, which just closely connected us. So, to me, it's a great honor to speak about Gerry, and that's speaking not just about the person whom you read about, this is speaking about person whom you know very well, and I really grateful to the ISU summer session program leaders who invited me, issued invitation to give you this night talk. Okay. I think Gerry would be very much pleased if you could a chance to know that I selected a topic which was very much close to his scientific interest, because his interest in life finding, in some kind of the science features of the life or precursors of life, was related also to the study of meteorite matter. So when I got an invitation to speak tonight, I thought a little bit, and then I decided just to tell you quite interesting story about the so-called Chelyabinsk meteorite. This historical event, it's happened only 2 years ago, a little bit more. And throughout this time, I've been deeply involved in the study, first of all, in observations. I've been on the time of the meteorite fall, waked up by telephone call. It was Saturday, I still slept. And it was a great disturbance, a great excitation. And immediately, I tried to encourage people, some team, to go to the Chelyabinsk Ural Mountains area in order just to start finding some fragments of this explosion and then falling. Okay, so I certainly limited in time, so I apologize being quite brief, but I try to deliver you that the main results of the study, which was conducted for about 2 years, specifically in my Vernadsky Institute. And we have excellent meteorite lab in this institute, and also world-recognized collection of the meteorite. And so Chelyabinsk meteorite just contributed to our study. That is the outline of my lecture. I will try to get you acquainted with the main results of observations. And it was not only scientific observations, but also just the residents' observations, and also the results of the lab studies and some kind of the simulation. So, a few introductory remarks. In order not to follow a meteorite falling down the floor, I will stay here. Okay, so, Chelyabinsk meteorite fell down the Earth on the 15th February, 2013, 9:15 a.m. Well, basically, it was quite routine astronomical phenomena. We have many meteorites, you know, just falling down the Earth's surface, and especially in ocean. Some of them just already being found and delivered in the different meteorite collection and different labs. But this is very specific. The first time in the history, the event was very well documented. And the fragments of meteorite were found and delivered to the lab basically immediately. So they were not contaminated, being just for some time, you know, just weathered and impacted by some kind of weather conditions and also the soil. So this attracted great attention of the resident people, And well, certainly they very much shocked with the event. And I will show you in several minutes, some of them were punished for their curiosity. Okay, so this piece, this chunk of the larger body, and we try to reconstruct its parameter. And certainly, detailed study of the key importance for the cosmogony, not cosmology. Cosmogony, this is the science about just origin and early evolution of our planetary systems, solar system, and other planetary systems. Okay. Also, this was a great warning because it's just raised concern about the potential threat to our planet from these bodies coming and impacting to our planet. Okay, that is the publication which summarize the main results. This was published in the Solar System Research magazine, for which I'm editor-in-chief, and also Geochemistry International. And it was already made in July, August of 2013, and also a year later, the main results were summarized in this book, published only in Russian, unfortunately, but this is available in the different labs right now. Okay. Usually, we know that there could be four basic scenarios of the meteorite fall. First of all, it could be direct collision with the surface, and together with the bow shock, it forms a crater on the surface. And we have just evidence of the numerous impacts on the celestial bodies. Such, for example, you have the heavy cratered surface of the moon, and such also atmosphereless planets like Mercury or even Mars. Atmospheric explosion caused by nearly complete evaporation and fragmentation of the body, and basically not a single fragment reached the surface. Then the surface explosion caused by the high-speed jet, which mostly composed of the dust, fine fragments of the original body, and also together with the bow shock, some part of this fragmented body reach the surface. And finally, it's the ordinary meteor phenomena. This is quite small particles, mostly dust, which just burn out, evaporate in the Earth's atmosphere. So typical example of the atmospheric explosion is Tunguska event, which occurred over Siberia in 1908. And Chelyabinsk event is just classified as surface explosion. So partially it's reach fragmented, and some fragments reach the surface. Well, because it was very brightly illuminated during the entering the Earth's atmosphere, it was called bolide. Such meteorite events usually classified like bolides. And the larger body, the deeper certainly it penetrates in the atmosphere, and there's more fine fragments leaving behind. Basically, just to be clear, meteoroid is just like an asteroid, but much smaller size. Asteroids are ranged from several hundred kilometers to, say, 100 meters. Meteoroids, it's just bodies, likewise asteroids, but much smaller in size, usually tens and even units of meter, okay? So that's basically such bolides, they begin to evaporate and begin to become luminous at about 40, 50 kilometers, and where the maximum drag and occur because they meet quite dense atmosphere. So there are numerous bolide events which have been recorded. That's basically, you know, that the whole globe is dotted with the bolide events. But I here summarized only for the latest several decades, most prominent is the South Africa, Marshall Island bolide, Indonesia bolide, and Vitim bolide. But the energy release was something within several tens, maximum 100 KT, kiloton TNT. Okay. What are the main characteristics of the Chelyabinsk bolide? Original size was something like about 18 meters. This just original, I mean, before meteorite began to partially ablated and evaporated. Original mass was something like 10,000 tons. Mass loss because of ablation began at about 40, 50 kilometers. Destruction in the pieces happened below 40 kilometers. Main destruction at between 23, 29 kilometers. Hot dust formed from the evaporated mass, and it had very bright orange color fireball. And remaining part of the body fragmented at the explosion and scattered. And only from the original 10,000 ton, about 10 ton was, or it's just only 0.1% of the original mass preserved like fragments, meteorite fragments. And they were, as I said, scattered for over the quite large area, and some fragments, only less than 1 ton, reach the surface. So from original 10,000 ton, only about 1 ton reach the surface. Okay, about ground observations and accompanying effects. This is trajectory of Chelyabinsk meteorite and meteorite shower. This is the trajectory. Meteorite entered the atmosphere and came from the southeast direction. So from this direction, and this is the trace, and this is the main meteor showers. This is the Chelyabinsk here, and this is the Lake Chebarkul. This is important to remember because it's just the site where the main part of meteorite just plunked in. And this is meteor showers, and fragments are ranged from a few grams to several kilograms. And they are sized with the different cycles. So this is quite more or less limited area, and the fragments which were picked up, found, it was just in this region. So, important thing, because meteorite entered the Earth with the velocity, something like about 20 kilometers per second, it was not recorded by the different facilities, specifically just, you know, deployed in order to record both natural or artificial objects, okay? So they missed it. And especially the reason for that meteorite came from the sunshine side, okay? So the people and the facilities network were completely blind. Now, aftermath of the explosion It's just meteorite shower, just what I show with you. And also, there are some deviation from the trajectory because of the wind which scattered this fragments from the main trajectory by about 2.5 kilometers. Okay, observations. Observed observers witnessed great brightness, and even they felt quite hot by their skin. And the brightness at the maximum brightness corresponded to the minus 17 stellar magnitude. For non-astronomer, I could comment that Vega, the brightest, one of the brightest stars in our skies, is only 0.03 stellar magnitude. Venus, at the maximum elongation, is only minus 4.5. And our sun, minus 26.8. And, I guess I have here also the moon. The moon is something like as comparable to this, a little bit less, something like minus 13, 14. Okay, these are coordinates, which was quite reliably established. Velocity of the vertical drift, the clouds, which was formed, just raised the product of the explosion by about several hundred meters and several tens kilometers, which such a velocity shown here. And bow shock was formed, which reached the surface in about 3 minutes, between 1.5 and 3 minutes. And maximum destruction caused certainly by the bow shock, not by the fragments themselves. And it's covered about 10 regions in the vicinity of Chelyabinsk. So 1,500 people addressed for the medical assistance. And 100 just, you know, were placed in the hospital, and even a few in reanimation. And mostly it was cutting by the, you know, pieces of glass, because people just stared, touching to the glasses, and was you know, smashed, and they suffered from that. Okay, it was basically the first historical event when people suffered from the cosmic event, you know. The first in the history. It's very interesting. Okay, this is video records of the explosion, and they are marked here by such clots. And this is Chelyabinsk, and this is the Chebarkul. And, these are photos of luminescence and inverse tracks. And an interesting record here, just at the lower left corner. This is just, you know, traced and recorded just at the maximum luminosity of the meteorite. So this is the main burst, and this is subsequent bursts. And this is the meteorite trace in the Earth's mesosphere, above something like 50, 60 kilometers. This is a sequence of images taken by Meteosat-2 satellite. Well, the event was also recorded by the acoustic, infrasound, and seismic facilities. And sounds were in the wave, in the range of something like between 20,000 and 20,000 kilohertz, and infrasonic waves at the, infrasonic waves with the frequency something like 3,000 hertz was propagated through the so-called atmospheric channels, and it was recorded by the 11 special infrasonic stations which deployed and specifically in Russia, in order to record as a potential nuclear explosions, okay? So, seismic waves were in the range 2.74 bal in magnitude, and mostly were caused by the bow shock and recorded at the distance of several thousand kilometers. Also, meteorite explosion, formation of the bow shock influenced dramatically upper atmosphere. It was responsible, first of all, just lifting of the product of the explosion into mesosphere, and it was effect very much resembling what we have at the atmospheric explosion of nuclear weapon, okay? And also, disturbances occurred in the ionosphere. Ionosphere, specifically throughout basically the whole ionospheric layers, but mostly in EC and F2 layers, and increase of electronic concentration occur by more than 2.7 times, okay? And the event preserved for about 1 day. Okay, now, aerodynamic of entry, energy release, and reconstruction of the meteoroid entry trajectory. Well, I would say, generally, just aerodynamics of the meteorite impact and interaction with the Earth's atmosphere is quite well known. It was studied and published in many, many papers. So this event didn't differ dramatically from what we basically know. But let me just explain what happened. Just meteorite, when entering the atmosphere, met that the most dense atmosphere already at height about 29 kilometers. And then it began fragmented, okay? Many dust particles and larger size fragments formed. And because of such kind of fragmentation, just at the front surface, expanding dramatically, okay? And it means that you increase cross-section, and cross-section under very high velocity caused extremely high temperature and bow shock formation. So it was formed very hot plasma with the temperature something we estimated something like 10,000 Kelvin. It's a very high, enormous temperature. And it was very luminous, very bright, bright luminosity. And also it was something like, many product, like the fragments of this explosion, scattered around, and some of them fall to the surface. So, for Chelyabinsk meteorite, we estimated the energy release, and it turned out in the vicinity something like between 300 and 500 kiloton TNT, trinitrotoluol. Let me remind you that 1 kiloton of TNT is 4 multiplied to 10 to 12 joule. So it's enormous energy release. Okay, now, it was also energy release was figured out independently, and it was made by the solution of the so-called inverse problem. That, it's some kind of an attempt to reconstruct what pressure you need in order just to distract, say, window glasses, okay? And this just was made, and turned out that excess pressure was something like about 500 Pascal. 500 Pascal was reconstructed to the original explosion, and it gave rise the same estimate of the energy which was obtained through the aerodynamic analysis. And well, that's some notes is that it's again fully comparable with what we have from the testing of the nuclear weapons. Trajectory of the meteorite was very accurately reconstructed based on the observations of its passing through the atmosphere, and several group of astronomers came to the very similar conclusion. So this table summarized the main finding. Semi-major axis, it turned out around 1.5 astronomical unit. Let me remind you, that's just the orbit of Mars, 1.5. So it's nearby Mars orbit. Eccentricity, much larger than for Mars orbit, because for Mars it's only 0.03. And inclination also much larger than the Martian orbit. And then some other parameters, I wouldn't discuss it in more detail. But reconstruction gave rise to the, just came us to the conclusion that it was a fragment of the larger body which entered atmosphere, and this body was just a chunk of possibly even larger body belonging to NEO of Apollo family. Apollo family, I will tell you a little bit later, just what it means in classification of the near-Earth objects. Well, possibly of special interest in the results of cosmochemical study and reconstruction of the meteorite history. Well, this is a sample of the Chelyabinsk meteorite fragments. They are scaled with this ruler. So you can witness easily very inhomogeneous structure, texture of this meteorite involving both gray, or we call it white, and black matter. And well, I showed you just the pieces which was collected, fragments of the explosion, but the larger part of the meteorite, they flew further on and plunked to the Chebarkul Lake. Interestingly, it's just a splash, just destroyed the upper ice cover, and later, something like in about 2 months later, was excavated from the lake bottom. And this piece, this one, turned out with mass more than 500 kilograms. So this is a great chunk which preserved atmospheric entry. And this is just what I said. This is a different viewing of this piece, larger piece of the meteorite, also with not uniform texture. And this is the smaller part, only 65 kilograms, which just split it off, you know, just cut it off that the main meteorite piece. Okay. We certainly identified which class of meteorite this body belonged to. This was made through the several cosmochemical analysis. This is diagrams of different classes of meteorites, and in the along relative to axis, ferrum iron oxide to silicon, and also ferrum metallic to ferrum sulfide. That is quite routine analysis, quite well familiar to the specialists in the meteorite study, and turned out that the Chelyabinsk meteorite very well fitted to the class LL. And also, some other analysis was made just in the frame shown here in the plotted, like ferrum in olivine mineral and cobalt abundance in the iron, and special iron which enrich with nickel, we call it kamacit. So again, this analysis came us to the conclusion that the Chelyabinsk very well fitted to the LL class meteorites. Also, it was studied in terms of the ratio of iron abundance and in the meteorites and in minerals of meteorites of different type, different classes. This is phyalite, the so-called phyalite in olivin. Sorry for the Russian subscription here. And this is ferrum silicium in orthopyroxene. And again, we have Chelyabinsk very well fitted to LL class. So, summarizing, Chelyabinsk meteorite is just the stony class meteorite, this ordinary chondrite, having quite low relative ratio of iron and containing about 60% in its matrix, the so-called chondrules, refractive materials. The main phases are olivin and pyroxene. Ferrum abundance and in the ratio of its oxidized and reduced forms, as well as content of phyalite in olivin and ferrosilicium in pyroxene, allowed us to identify the meteorite as the chemical class LL. Petrological analysis was also carried out, and it came us to the conclusion that it's the meteorite of fifth petrological class, and it means that its experience in its history heating up to 700-750 degrees. So it was some kind of, let just to be a little bit advanced, it was some shock events in the meteorite history, which such kind raising of the temperature of its matter, its matrix. And meteorites also was attributed to the group of meteorite shock metamorphed bodies, so-called S4. And it's experienced shock loading something like about 30 gigapascal. So it's quite great shocking. So finally, Chelyabinsk meteorite was classified like ordinary chondrite LL5S4. And it's such identification was placed in the special catalogs of the International Meteorite Society. Meteorites have quite peculiar structure. You may see that it's just not only uniform, as I already said, matrix, but there are many cracks and different kind of the veins. So, and it means that it was many shocks in the history of meteorite fragmentation, which not possibly fully occurred during these historical events, but some of them also were complemented during the meteorite entry in the Earth's atmosphere, and the destruction occurred along such veins. That's meteorite mostly composed of the gray and black color matter, and this black matter, similar in composition to this one, they are just witness that it was some melt. So this is in confirmation that the shock events happened in the history of this body, and this melt events just demonstrate us such kind of the aftermath of these collisions. This more clearly seen structure of the meteorite, this is this image, was made in the inverse scattered electrons. Again, clearly seen gray, even more white and black spots, clots in the matrix. And the abundance of the chemical elements, I have no time to discuss it in more detail. These are the main elements listed here, and they are for white phase, a black phase of the meteorite, quite comparable and very well fitted to the chondrite LL class of meteorites. So, reconstruction of the meteorite history was made based on the, not only on the morphology, but also on the isotopy analysis. Age of the meteorite derived from the isotopy of lead, it's shown here, turned out 4.55 billion years. Let me remind you that at this age of the solar system is like this. So the meteorite only 30 million years younger than the age of the solar system. So it looks like coeval of the solar system. Okay, shock melt, black faced, appeared to form early in that epoch. So it's the first shocks which meteorite experienced. Another shock, which was also witnessed by the isotopy analysis, turned out about 300 million years ago. This is the base of neodymium, samarium neodymium isotopic data analysis. Certainly, we continue the study, and possibly quite remarkable page in the history of meteorite will be still open. This is just a plot of the lead isochrons analysis, which just allowed us to establish the age of this meteorite. And possibly final interesting point relating to the study. You know, we have special lab in my institute which study cosmic rays. And the study cosmic rays is based on the crystals, very accurate analysis of crystals and tracks which caused by the cosmic rays, both solar cosmic rays and galactic cosmic rays. These traces are shown here with arrows, some of them. And this allowed us just to shed some light on the history, not only meteorite itself, but on the history of the cosmic rays in the universe. That's very important indeed. Okay, my final point, which I would like to draw your attention at, it's just very closely related to the asteroid comet hazards. And this, the problem of the, just what people discussing here during the summer session, planetary defense. Okay, the main families, just to remind you, the main families of the small bodies, they are located in the Oort cloud, and within this Oort cloud, this area, which we call Kuiper Belt. Oort cloud, outer edge, it's something like 10^5 astronomical unit. It's just the periphery, very periphery of the solar system. And Kuiper Belt is located beyond Neptune at the distance about 30-40 astronomical unit. By the way, right now we could just applaud to people and just the NASA people who just made and a very good friend of mine, Alan Stern, who was just in charge of the remarkable project New Horizon. And New Horizon, 11 years after launch, right now just reached Kuiper Belt and study just the pieces, different bodies which populate this formation, and specifically flying by Pluto, which like a member of Kuiper Belt, no more planet disregarded like dwarf icy planet in the Kuiper Belt. And this is different pieces of the asteroid and also nucleus, cometary nucleus, which just, you know, allow us to recognize the real threat which could be to our Earth, because some of them migrating inward the solar system, have a chance to be in the collision with our planet. Okay, and this is another formation of the small body much closer to the solar system. This is the main asteroid belt, and this is in green, and in red, this is the bodies which migrate from the main asteroid belt towards the sun, and you can, if you have sharp eyes, you can see here just orbits. This is the Mercury and our Earth, and this is the Jupiter. Okay, and this is the family of NEO, near Earth asteroids. That is just, this is Amor, which this is Earth orbit, okay? This is Amor orbits of the many bodies, the hundred such, thousand such bodies. And they only approach orbit of our Earth. Apollo, they have entering even the Earth orbit. And some of objects even penetrate up to orbit of Venus. So this group, especially Apollo 1, is most dangerous in terms of the threat to our planet. And these are just, you know, interesting superposition. That is the orbits of the all planets up to Mars. And this is orbits of NEO, near Earth object, and this is superposition. So you may see that we live in not very much pleasant environment. And also we have very threatening evidence that such events happens even during the time of our generation. Let me remind you that in 1994, what we held summer session in Barcelona. It was just at the great event, Shoemaker-Levy 9 comet, which was torn asunder in the vicinity of Jupiter, and 21 pieces of this comet fragmented. And each piece was something like about 1 kilometer across, and they subsequently entered the Jupiter atmosphere and caused greatest explosion equivalent of the million megaton bombs, okay? So it's a real threat. And we do not exist, this is artist certainly concept, we do not exist isolated in the solar system. This is some kind of the permanent exchange of the matter between planets as some larger bodies penetrate and pose threat to our planet indeed. So, the cosmic red, just Chelyabinsk event reminded us that such situation really exists. This is not some kind of the speculation of scientists, which some, you know, decision makers not always believe, but this is a real event, and primary goal is just to protect our planet, and first of all, in order to do that, we need just to carry out quite accurate observations. And specifically, just the bolide also provide a threat, while they're only something like Chelyabinsk between 20 and 50 meters across usually. But it could be much larger body, and beginning of 100 meters across, it's already bodies which could provide real disaster, especially in the populated areas. So the next step is just to develop some active methods in order to prevent such events. Okay, and this is the collision rate, which was estimated, and basically this is just the statistics. This is a long coordinate probability of impact per 1 year, and this is diameter of the body in kilometer. Just let me show you, this is 10 meters, and this is 100 meters. So
60 meters. This is just Tunguska. And Tunguska, it's just happening something like about once in 100 years. And let me remind you that in Tunguska, energy release was something like 10 KNT. Ten kiloton TNT. Okay, so this is a real disaster, and Chelyabinsk is something like here, and these events could happen even something like about between 50 and 100 years. So this just what we threatened, indeed, like it's a cosmic events, and certainly in the history of our planet, there were much more powerful events. And this is a quite well-known Chicxulub, which just was caused. This is a crater in Mexico. And this crater, something like about 300 kilometers across, was formed by a body about 10 kilometers across, okay? And it happened 65 million years ago. It's very accurately dated. And some people speculating, I not completely just, you know, argue for the same, but some people speculate that it was just event which was devastating specifically for the Earth's biosphere and related with the reptiles' decay. Okay. And just to show you, the comets possibly pose even more threat. And well, this is the cartoon from newspaper of dated 1910, when it was just approach of Halley comet was before the last one in 1986. And people at that time, especially in Hans, exaggerated the danger from such kind of the comet. But, and this is the cartoon shows that it's a comet which was usually associated with the bringing a sort of misfortune, okay? They just could collide even and turn asunder our planet. But certainly, as I'm saying, this is very much enhancing, but we really realize right now that it's potential threat, potential space hazards, which we should be very much concerned about. Okay, and nicely, we just only 2 days ago had the so-called asteroid and meteorite day celebrated by our student community quite actively. And this is just in this day, before that, in April, it was a trace of the meteorite or the meteor in the Liris meteor shower, which was traced at the background of the Milky Way. So, what we can conclude? Meteorite Chelyabinsk was really quite unusual historical event, because it's the first time in the history it was very well documented, and the pieces of the matter were not completely contaminated. This is absolutely fresh. So, and I, believe me, quite legally, I just brought with me a piece of this body. You know, this is really exciting to keep in your hand, just touch with your fingers, just a matter were formed not on our Earth. It was not just specific achievements in technology. This is achievements of the nature itself. So, if you wish, you could look at that, okay? But please, don't put me in the position just to be prisoned when returning back, because this is just what I should return to our lab. Okay, so this is the story of meteorite which I told you. We absolutely have absolute evidence that it's ordinary chondrite of LL5 type, and the study of small bodies and their fragments, they are especially important for the shedding light on the history of our solar system and basically even on the life origin. You know, I have a great chance to study these problems just from two sides. One approach is the mathematical modeling. We use quite powerful tools, very nice, very effective computers, and we develop quite complicated model in order to reconstruct the history. You have no other approach, no other chance to penetrate deep in the history of this, our solar system origin. But every mathematical model should be verified, and verification coming from testing of what was in the real nature. And in the real nature, some remnants of the processes involving chemical reactions, different kind of the phase transformation, different kind of the, just what I showed you, shocking events and so on, they could be studied only just with the very much intact and detailed analysis of the matter itself. That is the most important constraints which we placed on the models. So that's what we are doing, and Chelyabinsk meteorite contributed at least a little bit to our former knowledge, and it was really great donation from the God himself, and specifically important that it was donated for free. We, you know, discussing different kind of the space missions to be organized, to be launched in order just to land on the different solar system bodies and return some pieces of matter. Right now, but such expeditions, such missions cost a lot. I wouldn't advocate that we answered the all questions, but we had quite good piece of information in order just to get inside. And let me again repeat, basically for free. And that's important. So I acknowledge many of my colleagues whom with I made such a study throughout the latest 2 years, specifically people from my cosmochemical laboratory and other laboratories of the Russian Academy of Science institutions. And I especially thankful to the people whom we discussed quite intensively, discuss many specific items in order to reconstruct the meteorite history. Okay, let me conclude that I am absolutely confident that Gerry Soffen, sitting here, would he sit among us, would appreciate that we so much progressed in the field, in the particular field of his scientific interest. Thank you for your attention. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.
Can you answer some questions?
Sure.
So basically, this was a very kind of fortunate case that the meteor fell into Russia in terms of, like, you know, it's one of the biggest landmass on the planet. and that there is a Russian Academy of Science that could like very fast like address the issue and get the material while it's still fresh, right? But the second biggest like landmass next to Asia is Africa. So what will happen if this kind of thing happened in Africa? Who would be in charge of retrieving this material, and where would it go? Would it go?
Okay, just briefly, what would happen if that event happened, say, not in Russia, but in some other areas over the globe, for example, in Africa or Asia, okay, some regions like that. Well, it's meteorite, do not select which country to impact. It's very far away from the political reasons. But certainly, it's absolutely critical which area will be impacted, whether it populated or not. Certainly, I agree that for African countries, it would be possibly even more disaster for the in the poverty they have. And in Russia, not with the assistance of the Academy of Science, but with the local legislators, it was provided very good assistance to the people who suffered from that. That for sure. But the main threat of the Chelyabinsk, as I said, it's the first time in quite populated area. And, let me tell you even more, answering your question. We a little bit extrapolated. That is the trace of meteorite impact. And then very interesting, the trajectory just facing St. Petersburg. You could imagine extremely populated area with the greatest cultural heritage. So some people a little bit disagreed, just, extrapolated trajectory and said, no, not St. Petersburg, Germany. To me, it makes no difference. But most important, that such event really even could have even worse, results if the entry would happen only a few minutes later. You could imagine. So, I think, because you mentioned about other countries, I should say that's the, just the problem solution of the cosmic hazards. It's absolutely international endeavor, absolutely. And many countries should pool their efforts.
Hi, thank you for your lecture. I was wondering, I have two questions. The first one is there any idea of what may have caused the shock melt event from 300 million years ago? And the second one is it possible to date the cosmic rays that are kind of traced in the meteor?
Possibly I not completely follow you. Could you just comment a little bit?
So I believe you said that there was maybe a shock or a melting event in the meteor 300 million years ago.
Okay.
Is that, I think that's what it said. Do you know what caused that?
Well, if you keep in mind just what happened in that far epoch, it's just regular event, absolutely regular And if we address back to the plot which I showed you, then, you know, it was in logarithmic scale. So this is exponentially decreasing probability with raising size. Okay? Is reciprocal.
Yeah.
And according to this diagram, we have evidence statistically that the event of something like 10 kilometers across body could impact Earth once in 100 million years.
And my second question is, so you said there was, you showed an image of, like, they detected cosmic ray traces inside the meteorite.
Uh-huh.
Are you able to date when those cosmic events occurred?
Yeah. Well, it's a good question. Again, basically, it depends not only on the path itself. It depends on some kind of the configuration of these traces. And they are caused by the different mass of cosmic rays particles. Okay? So the reconstruction is not so simple, but people already collected quite good statistics for that.
What tools or technologies are useful for watching for these threatening bodies? Is it telescopes or is radar useful?
You know, when we are saying how to alleviate at least hazards, the first step forward is just accurate observations. So, record the bodies with of different size as accurate as possible. And for this, certainly, we need to collect as much data with accurate observation as possible. We have quite good network on the Earth, ground-based telescopes, but it's not yet sufficient. Let me show you, let me tell you, that 1 kilometer asteroid impacting Earth, it's a global disaster. Not only because it's just a devastation of the impact area, but also because if some kind of the aftermath, something like, you know, some kind of the so-called, you know, it was just develop such kind of the scenario by Carl Sagan, Thun, and others, the so-called nuclear winter. Just the same, you know, such impact, especially for our very well-advanced society with a lot of plastics. This is the burning and a lot of dust in the atmosphere screening sun and with no harvesting for years ahead. So, but even 1 kilometer size body, they are put in the catalog less than 90%. You could imagine that the total number of such bodies estimated by possibly about 1,000. And smaller body size. So the more such bodies exist. And even 100 meters, several hundred meters across, it's a great devastation for the area. So, I was very much pleased to know most recently, you know, it was 4 years already discussing that ground-based facilities not very well efficient. And we need just some kind of the space telescope deployed in order just to warn about such bodies approaching Earth from different directions. Basically in the real time. And just most recently, NASA announced, unfortunately not Russia. I wish it would be Russia, but they are only just discussing. But NASA already announced about the project, something like 3 meter across telescope to be launched in my memory 2019 in quite high, something like 500-700 kilometer orbit, and possibly just with a very wide angle, like good aperture, in order just to trace the space basically from the whole directions. And the project oriented to find something like 500,000 objects less than 1 kilometer across for about 5 years. So this is the first step forward. The second, but it's still mostly speculations, is the safeguard system which I mentioned, just to deploy some kind of missiles equipped with the nuclear weapons in order just to launch and to try to not to destroy, but to deviate trajectory of such dangerous body.
Question here. So it's evident that we're not, I'm right here.
Yes.
It's evident that we're not prepared for this kind of threat at this moment. So what can we do today to be a little bit prepared if this happens in 1 to 2 years?
Today, hopefully not. So we have no any evidence that it could happen just in the coming time, you know. But I cannot advocate that quite unexpectedly, comet, for example, will appear, which not quite clear observed. For asteroids, we right now capable to trace even as small bodies as only several tens meters. By the way, possibly you look at my charts, it was said that only a few days later after Chelyabinsk, another body of similar size flew by our planet. Okay? And keep this in mind. It's happened at the distance only 15,000 kilometers. Okay? Geostationary orbit, 36. So it's very close. And closer, the more probability to be captured by the gravity field and just to impact. So, but right now, I wouldn't share any, you know, threat, any kind of, you know, too much care about that. So just what I can advocate, sleep well.
Mikhail, my friend, I'd like to share on behalf of all of us here some gifts with you. I think we all appreciate your expertise, and we thank you for traveling so far to be with us these weeks, and thank you again for volunteering to do this lecture. I think it is the perfect capstone to our 4 weeks of a very intense evening lectures, and I thank you, my friend, for doing this.
Thank you, John. Okay. Thank you.